So far, so good.
Congratulations, ma'am. Hope we don't you don't develop any symptoms after this, any post-vaccination effects.
So far, so good, I'm saying. I've had it today around 2 o'clock. Okay, have we read the cases for today? Yes, no, maybe. What is the first case? Facts of the first case. Now I have this rule in my classes that if nobody reads something which we have asked you to read, then the topic is or the subject matter of the reading is assumed to have been covered. They've got my deputation letter, so I'll be leaving soon. And if I see no, if I do not find people working with me and preparing for the classes, I see no reason why I should make the effort of finishing this course sitting in Orissa. If I'm going an extra mile and you do not work on it, then forget it, you will have another teacher.
The case is State of UP versus Ram Swarup.
Great.
In this case, ma'am, there are two parties. Actually, they got a conflict between them in a market, in a vegetable market. The appellant went to the market for buy for watermelon, to a shopkeeper, but he denied. He said this is already picked by someone else, and this create there a conflict between those parties. And the shopkeeper said that I am the authority of the market, and I will not allow to buy anything. And there is some hot debate or things happen between them, and the person the appellant take it on his ego and went back to home and bring with him 2 or 3 persons. And after they then after they come to the market, and they shouted over there that we will tell you who is authority in this market. And the conflict happened between them, and the both parties get fighting start fighting with each other during the whole incident. The opposite the respond respondent party try to hit the appellant, but they find some on side of appellant there is a person who finds that his father is in danger, and he tried to escape his father, and then he finds that his father is about to die, or someone is trying to kill him. He finds the attention of that of his father, and he shoot on that person, and that person got died. So, ma'am, this is a scenario of this case.
Okay, you have certainly read the case. It may be useful to mention who all or how many persons were in party A and how many on party B. We say that the two parties to this case, who died by action of whom? Because I think it's important to now, because it's a case of joint liability. It's a group of people who are working together against a group of people. So that's another concept that we will read in greater detail as to how do we impose liability on people who have not, on a person who himself or herself has not done the act, but may still be imputed to that person. So that's a concept we will learn in joint liability by reference to Section 34 and Section 140, 140, 149, etc. This case, of course, we are reading from the perspective of private defense. So the whole scenario has arisen because party A, and let's say that this is the accused party, they had contract of tehbazari in the area for a number of years, excepting one. For a long time they had that. Then around the time when the incident happened, somebody else got that contract. So when the first party went to ask for certain goods from the new contractor, he said these are already sold. So they took it as a personal affront. They went back home. So then, Jitin, how many people came and what were they carrying with them? So this is an incident. This is an incident which is said to have happened in the early morning. So, which, you know, there's been some kind of a doubt whether this happened or not, but this is what the prosecution side is, that there was a prelude to what happened actually, in which the new contractor side person, the what is his name, the
Gangaram and Ramsurup and the prosecution side.
Yeah. So now who died? Who died?
Munimji.
Munim. The Munimji, right. So, okay. So, when the earlier contractor was refused the things to be sold, then they went back home and came back. So, who all came back? Were they related to each other? Four people returned, Rahul. Who are these four people? Are they related to each other? Are they independent? And this is a fact, important fact, because if people are related to each other, it is easier to prove that they all came together. If there were no connection, maybe four people came from different kinds. So Gangaram and his three sons came. Ramsharup and three sons are on the other side. So, yeah, so tell me now, tell me the story. So these four people who came back, what were they carrying with on them?
They were carrying a gun with single cartridge, I think.
Okay. Who was carrying the gun?
Ram Swarup.
And Ram Swarup,
the son of Gangaram.
Son of Gangaram. Right. So, and there were somebody else with them?
Yes, ma'am. The other two sons.
Gangaram carrying
Somi
knife.
And Subhash.
Gangaram was carrying knife. Ram Swarup had a gun.
Somi and Subhash also, they with them.
And who are they?
They have lathis.
No. Who
Somi
are they?
Somi and Subhash.
Somi and Subhash are who?
They are also his
they are the sons of Gangaram.
So there's a Gangaram.
They are the other two sons of Gangaram.
So Gangaram returned with three sons?
Yes,
sir. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
So Gangaram had a knife, Ram Swarup had a gun, and the two other sons had lathis. So they came back, and when was that statement made that who will say, who? No, now we will see who is the master of this area. So then what happened? They came back to the same shop. Then what happened?
No, I don't think anyone was carrying gun from their side. They were carrying lathis and all, and the son of this side fired round at them and they started running away. In which
which side? Ram Swarup side fired the gun. So they were not carrying gun. How did they fire?
They were carrying the gun with only one cartridge.
That doesn't matter, but they were carrying a gun.
Yeah, they were carrying.
So they had a gun, they had lathi, they had a knife. Yes. So then what happened? Once they returned to the scene, then what happened there? But no, in these kind of cases, it's important to go step by step. Because only then we will know whether Ram Swarup's party was defending themselves or they were the aggressor. So their defense is that, no, we were we were acting in private defense. We fired because my father was being attacked by the other side. And therefore, in order to protect my father, I fired in private defense. And therefore, it is important to know that, you know, step by step, what happened then?
And the challenge...
It's you, the challenge.
You said that... Yes, ma'am. The challenge, Muniji said that, now tell me who is the authority over here.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly, the attackers came with lathis and all, and Ram Swarup was on the protecting side. He was protecting his father, and he fired gunshots, and they all scattered and started running, in which few people got killed. The attackers got killed. The protector, I think it would
It is not enough to say attackers. Who are the attackers? Who are the people you're referring to as attackers?
Ma'am, yes, according to the defense story, that Gangaram was assaulted with lathis by Shivadatta Mal, public prosecution witness 5. So, and there are some other servants who, of the Muhimji. So, they are all assaulted Gangaram. So, these are the narration of defense, ma'am. Gangaram was assaulted.
Precisely, that is the, and so that is where Ram Swarup are saying we were acting in private defense. And the question is, were they acting in private defense or were they the aggressor? Because if they first start attacking and then they get cornered and become more vulnerable, then they cannot say that now they are the attackers. The whole question is, in this case, who is the attacker and who is the victim?
Gangaram and Ram Swarup party of attacker.
So they were the ones who were the earlier contractors of Teh Bazari?
Yes, ma'am. This is one material fact that we had missed. Yes, that yes, except this year, this solitary year, they had been the munims for the market.
Yeah, so they wanted to assert their primacy, that itne saal se hum yahan ke malik hain, Teh Bazari saari hamare control mein chalti hai. Aur tum ab hame mana kar rahe ho. So this was main wali jo hota na issue. It is that story. So that how dare they stop me from purchasing. So we do not know whether the truth or not. But the whole thing, that their sense of their own pride and their status got challenged when the new contractor refused to sell them the goods. So then they come back. Then they say, okay, now let's settle out. No, who is the master here? So usme kaha suni inki hui. And then the other side. They were the ones who had come to settle the score. And then when Munimji and his party, who are people on the other side? Munimji had his servants around with him. So when they started beating, these people fired. Munimji was trying to run away. Munimji was even, as he had got up from his gaddi, and he was trying to run away also. But they shot him dead. So there were, I think, one shot fired, and this person died. Gangaram was also attacked. He was also taken to the hospital, I believe. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am, he was attacked.
And so Ram Swarup said, when I fired, I was acting in order to defend my father. So do you think they should be entitled to claim this, that they were defending their father? Because the law, we read the law yesterday, it says you should not be the aggressor. You should not have created the circumstance in which you find yourself in a private defense. So when they came back, what did they say? Why were they carrying a gun when they went back to that shop?
Ma'am, they had come to assert their authority.
No, because they're the defense now. What is the explanation to why were they carrying a gun?
Ma'am, for the safety purpose.
They said, I'm the usual matter, mein leke chalte hain. And if we had any pre-plan, if we had any pre-plan to attack, we would have taken more cartridges. We would have at least our gun loaded fully. Dunali banduk thi hamare paas, usme ek hi cartridge tha. So this is all the defense which is saying that we were carrying a gun not for the purpose of fighting or taking any action. But when we found, and they are denying that anything happened before this, the prelude of the morning incident is being denied by them. So this whole question is in these circumstances, whether when they fired at the Munimji, whether Ramsarup and party were acting in private defense. What did the court say? Anyone? What did the court say?
Ma'am, which one? The Sessions Court, High Court or the Supreme Court?
All the three, one after the other.
Ma'am, the Sessions Court held that the evidence presented by the prosecution witness is correct and they did not act in the right of private defense. While the High Court, while considering this evidence, proceeded with great caution and felt that since the servants were related to Munimji, this could not be trusted.
Mm-hmm.
And ma'am, I could not reach till the Supreme Court's judgment. I'm really sorry.
Okay. Anyone who has read the Supreme Court also?
Ma'am, Supreme Court held that the right of private defense is a right of private defense, not retribution. And it is available in the face of imminent peril to those who act in good faith. And in no case can the right be conceded to a person who stage manages a situation when the right can be used as a shield to justify an act of aggression.
So, aap Riviyat party pahunchi hai in the shop, they're challenging them. So once they have created that situation where scuffle, heating, you know, heat of passion, all that happened, and this is all pre-planned. The fact that all the four of them went together, they had some weapons on them, indicate that it was not a case of sudden fight. And this is not what has been granted. No, because if you said that, no, we just happened to be there with all our arms, etc., which we carry in our normal course of business. And then some argument happened, then led to fist fight, and then we were feeling very cornered. We were in danger. My father was in danger, and therefore I fired. That's what they want to present. But whether in the circumstances when there was a prelude to the incident, the fact that they were all armed, does it suggest that they had gone to do something? What that something will be, we do not know. Maybe they didn't intend to kill anyone. That may very much be true. But whether whatever action they had taken was in the right of private defense, whether, so what is the circumstance in which right of private defense arises? What did this action say?
It has to be grave and imminent danger, apprehension.
Is there something talking about sudden? No recourse to public authority.
No recourse to public authority. Yes.
The reasonable apprehension of danger to the body arises.
Tell me which section you are reading.
I think section
from
1 or 2.
From the section? Or from the section? Commencement and continuation. As soon as reasonable apprehension of danger to the body arises from an attempt or threat to commit an offense, though the offense may not have been committed, and it continues as long as the apprehension continues. So as soon as the reasonable apprehension of danger arises. And where were these exceptions there in when you say that, when we're talking about in section 102, the right of private defense of the body commences as soon as a reasonable apprehension of danger to the body arises from an attempt. So does it mean that in whatever circumstance, whether even when you have asked for that creation of that apprehension of danger, or does it mean that it must have come without premeditation, without having premonition that this is going to happen?
There should not be any premeditation that act will take place. It should take place like surprisingly, and a person is taken aback and he does something to in defense of his body or other's body and property.
Mm-hmm. Is there a section which mentions this?
One second.
What said anything about it? Suppose you are the, you know, very influential person, and somebody very meek and weak, Dalit, poor, destitute, you know, the person who's begging on the road, he says something, because you dare touch me. And then he dares touch you, and you say, oh, I've been now attacked, and therefore I will now take action in private defense. You ask yourself to be in that trouble. In this case, the situation has been that they came back with a clear intention to attack the other person. May not have been attacked necessarily to kill them, may not have been to even cause grievous hurt. But the fact that they came laced with weapons, what does it indicate? What were their intention? That they will settle the thing, whatever it takes. So if you have come back with that intention, can we say that you have the right, because a reasonable apprehension of body danger arose when Munims and his party started attacking them? There must not be, what is the comment here? Premeditation and the right to private defense should not be a pretext to seek retribution. So in this case, when they came back, were they seeking retribution? Were they wanted to take revenge? Or were they faced with a situation of attack on themselves suddenly?
They were the aggressors. They were acting in retribution.
Ah, so Shubham is right when he says that there was no direct evidence of previous incident. So how did the court deal with that aspect?
Ma'am, through witnesses.
No, but what is it that the court have said about it? You know, when you, I don't know what page number again is for you, mine is 138. It was at all stages undisputed that Ganga Ram and Ram Swarup went to the market at about 8 a.m., that one of them was armed with a gun, that a shot was fired from that gun by Ram Swarup, causing the death of Munimji. Though there was no direct evidence of the 7 o'clock incidents, the learned session judge accepted the prosecution case that the shooting was preceded by that incident. So even if there's no direct evidence, but from the circumstances, you know, the, one of the principles we have in law is that if a certain fact has been accepted as having been proved and it has not been challenged in the subsequent court also proceed on that, then you cannot raise the question of fact in the Supreme Court. So in this one, in coming to the conclusion, the learned judge relied upon the evidence of Sonara, Nanakchan, Shantilal, Shariat Ulla, and Shiva Dattamal, to whom the deceased had narrated the incident. So which means that this was told by Munimji to these persons. So in one sense, it's a hearsay category because they did not see it, but this was narrated to them. So, and this is what the deceased had already told about this on this. So on this basis, these witnesses were also examined in order to establish the main incident, and their evidence in that regard was also accepted by the learned judge. Having found that these witnesses were not trustworthy and their evidence established the case of prosecution, the learned judge proceeded to consider whether, as contended by Gangaram and Ramsarup, the shot was fired by Ramsarup in exercise of the right of private defense. Adverting to a variety of circumstances, the learned judge rejected their theory and held that the charges leveled against the two accused were proved beyond reasonable doubt. High Court disbelieved the evidence of the 7 o'clock incident. And here the High Court concluded the Gangaram was being given repeated lathi blows by Shiv Dattamal, PW, the PW's prosecution witness, and servants of the deceased, then Ramsarup had full justification to fire his gun in the right, and therefore he acquitted. It is against this acquittal by the High Court that the state has come in appeal to the Supreme Court. And here the next para, the point important for us is the burden which rests on the prosecution to establish its case beyond a reasonable doubt is neither neutralized nor shifted because the accused pleads the right of private defense. What does this mean? We know that we have been talking about there are two things in the criminal prosecutions. One is burden of proof. The second is standard of proof. So burden of
proof. In a standard of proof?
Yeah.
The prosecution
Just 1 second, Rahul. When we say burden of proof, we know that ordinarily the burden of to prove the case of the prosecution is on the prosecution. The defense lawyer's role is only to find loopholes in that story, in their evidence, in their cross-examination, to find that what the prosecution is alleging is not true. So that is what is meant by burden of proof. Standard of proof means that it has to be proved beyond reasonable doubt that this accused person has committed this offense. Then the other thing is that if an accused person is asking for a defense, he's saying that some exception applies. So then in that case, the burden to prove that the defense is applicable, that an exception is applicable, that burden is on the defense. But the judge here is saying that that burden arises only when the prosecution has first discharged its job of saying, yes, the accused person has done this act. So this is another important principle of law to learn, though not directly applicable in case of this decision. This decision, for our examination purposes, is only based on whether Ramsarup and party were aggressor or they were the defenders. So if you look at the previous story, the previous incident, it is more likely that they had come back to the incident, to the place to take revenge for what they thought was an insult to their status. If we do not have that story, if we do not believe that this is proved, then we will have to find out, then we have to see as to how things developed at that point of time. So going back to the case.
Ma'am?
Yes?
Does the accused need to prove the existence of right to private defense beyond reasonable doubt?
No. Because if they say it exists and there is a doubt because of this scenario, the defense burden is, you know, in there are exceptional case legislations in which the burden on the defense is also to prove the unreasonable doubt. And I know POXFA is one. And we recently read one more case in which also the process. So if there's a specific statutory provision which says the burden is on the defense to prove their defense beyond reasonable doubt, then it is so. But the general principle is that if they can create a doubt that maybe this exception applies, their burden is discharged. Because that would mean that prosecution story has a a doubt about it that maybe this is not the only way to look at it. So the judges now in this one, the Supreme Court is saying the Mellon incident formed a prelude to the main occurrence and was the immediate cause, was its immediate cause. By disbelieving it or by treating it alternatively as too trifling, the High Court was left to wonder why Gangaram and Ram Swarup went to the market armed with a gun, which they admittedly did. The case of the prosecution that they went back to the market to retaliate against the high-handedness of the deceased was unacceptable because the High Court said it does not stand to reason that the appellant and their two other companions would go in the lion's den in broad daylight and be caught and beaten up and even be done to death by the deceased, his partners and servants, besides hundreds of people who were bound to be present in the subsequently at about 8 a.m. So therefore, they said that no, they were going into the lion's den, which means that they said the High Court's understanding of the situation was that Munimji's party now was very powerful. And therefore, these people will not vote. The High Court also mentioned the fact that they had only one cartridge if they wanted to go to the lion's den and take revenge. Then they would have taken more cartridges. They would have at least have both the cartridge in their gun. So it was proved that it wasn't. So, and the Supreme Court says evidently they did go to the market, which to their way of thinking was not a lion's den, because Swarup and Ram Swarup's party thought they were powerful. They would have the support of the people. They have been in the Bazari contractor for a long time. So they did not think that Munimji, this is High Court's and Supreme Court's understanding of this situation. They went adequately prepared. The large congregation to which the High Court speaks of is often notoriously indifferent to situations involving harm or danger. Filmon mein dikhate hai na that lots of people are watching when two gundas are fighting with each other. So the fact that there will be so many people is not a deterrent for them. Yet another difficulty was that there was only the first shot went awry and did not hit the deceased. It was therefore necessary to have at least both the barrel loaded with cartridges. If they had gone to the murder, then they would have prepared themselves for it. The Supreme Court says no. When people are angry, they do not reason out everything. They must just pick up the gun and they went off. So the judges have, because these are the whole choices of determining what happened is an inference. So High Court would do one kind of inference. The trial court took one inference relying on the evidence given by the parties, and they were people present for the second round also. So the High Court, the trial court believed that. The High Court did not, and the interpretation of High Court was that if they had wanted to take revenge, they wanted to fight them, they would have gone with more preparation. But the Supreme Court has not accepted those objections raised by the High Court. The High Court applied to the mental process of the respondent to test far too rigid and unrealistic then was justified by the circumstances of the case and concluded. It is noteworthy that PW1 Sonaram clearly admits that Gangaram had a farm in village Nowshera, which is a distance of 2 miles from Badaayun. It is very likely that the two appellants must have been going every early morning to have a round of the vegetable farm, returning home there about 8 a.m. in the sultry month of June. It is not surprising that on such return to Badaayun on the morning of June 7, the appellant went to Sabzi Mandi in order to purchase melons when they were called to the gaddi of the deceased, ultimately resulting in fatal occurrence. The High Court assumed without evidence that Gangaram used to carry a gun. So this was one argument made by them that we carry a gun, but it was what they have not been able to prove. They have not made any evidence there to say that he used to carry the gun to going to a vegetable farm. And whole of the conclusion reproduced above would appear to be based on the thin premise that Sonaram had admitted the Gangaram had a village farm. So because he used to go there, therefore this, you know, he would have come only at 8 o'clock. This is too vague a statement. So look at how the why I wanted to wanted you to read actually para-wise thing is that in private defense, it's one is the question of private, and the other is also that how do you, somebody was asking the evidence question, how do you prove? So there's no eyewitness available for the first round of incident, then how the adjoining factors have been used by the court. In this case, the fact that there was a 2 mile away another farm, which ordinarily people will know that he will go and visit that farm. So that has been relied upon by the High Court to say, maybe only one incident happened. The right of private, so now there is the law which comes into operation, which the Supreme Court has explained in the para which begins, the right of private defense is a right of defense, not of retribution. It is available in the face of imminent peril to those who act in good faith. So were these people acting in good faith? And in no case can the right be conceded to a person who stage manages a situation wherein the right can be used as a shield to justify an act of aggression. If a person goes with a gun to kill another, an intended victim is entitled to act in self-defense. And if he so acts, there is no right in former to kill him in order to prevent him from acting in self-defense. While providing for the right to private defense, the penal code has surely not devised a mechanism whereby an attack may be provoked as a pretense for killing. So then they say they were angered by the rebuff in the morning of not selling it, and therefore they came back. The other important knowledge we get from this case, whether there is a duty to retreat. So if you are supposed being cornered in your house, so you have the choice, the intruder has come and has now said, hand over the property or I'll kill you or something like that. You are under pressure, you are in a situation where you can exercise right of private defense. So you have two choices. And suppose you have two choices. One is to attack this person, overpower him and hand him over the police. But it may be a possibility that the person may be more powerful than you are. And you have an escape route, you can actually run away. So should you run away? Must you run away? If you do not run away and try to take action in private defense, are you violating? There was a time when it was said that if you can escape the danger without attacking the other, you should escape. But this court, this case has also reiterated that now no more we expect, we impose or a duty on a person to run away from the scene of danger. Especially in circumstances when you have a right to be on that property. So Munimji was very much entitled to be on his property. He had no right to, no duty to run away. So the fact that he could have run away and saved his life is no defense, does not go in favor of the attackers. So suppose there is a couple, the wife in the couple is having an extramarital affair. So the boyfriend is caught red-handed by the husband, who is now ready to beat him or shoot him down. Whether the boyfriend has a right to private defense against his husband?
Ma'am, he has the right of private defense.
Does he has, suppose there was a possibility of escaping without attacking the husband?
Ma'am, law demands not to be coward. And like, if imminent danger is towards you or towards the property, then you should act as a brave person, like the Supreme Court emphasizes it.
So, but this man who is illegally there on the property of the husband, he is a trespasser to that property. Whether trespassers have a right to private defense?
But he has the permission of the wife, so how is that a trespass?
He can be sued for what wrong he is doing, but not, I mean, he has a right to still act in private defense.
whether his action can be seen as violating the property rights of the husband over the wife.
Yes.
No, ma'am.
No,
why
ma'am.
Not? Why not?
Because property also belongs to wife also, ma'am, because she is married to husband.
No. I'm not talking about the house. I'm talking about the wife.
Yes, ma'am. Whether, yes, ma'am. May I?
Or, yes, Rishabh.
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, in last year, I think, when adultery was discussed in Supreme Court stated that wife is not the property of husband, which was earlier believed mm-hmm. so.
So, if the husband, if no, but even today, we do know that marital rape is not an offense. So, whether this woman, the wife, has been considered as property of the husband, he can invade the property, the wife, as and when he wants. Even though adultery has been non-criminalized, but whether the property rights of the husband over the wife's body have been done away with? Things to think about, because certainly these are ticklish areas and upcoming, you know, new areas with new legislations and decisions coming in. In criminal law, we have seen many circumstances in which wife is considered to be the sexual property of the husband. And adultery law was very much about it. Because if she had sexual intercourse with another man with his consent, it was not an offense. So he could decide whether any other man will have sex with her or not. Of course, she also has to consent. But his permission would have taken the action out of the purview of adultery as it existed earlier. And then marital rape has not been recognized even till date. So we are, in a sense, are recognizing property rights, proprietary rights of the husband over the woman's body. And therefore, anybody violating, whether the husband would want to argue and saying that you were violating, no, you were posing a threat to my property, my wife, even though she's a consenting party, but law, when it says she will not be liable for even adultery, was saying she does not know what she's giving consent to. So these are the, you know, underpinnings of the law. The point I wanted to make out was that whether when we said that a person who is on the property lawfully has no obligation or a duty to run, but this man is not lawfully there. So if he's not, because this is today, even though adultery is no more a criminal offense, it still is a civil wrong. So whether when he's committing a civil wrong, which entitles the husband to take divorce or vice versa, it may be also. So whether that will make any difference in the manner in which we will view this situation to determine whether the husband was the victim of aggression by the boyfriend or whether the boyfriend was the victim of aggression by the husband who returned to his household to where he belongs. He has come to his own house. Returning back to our, which case? Ramswarup. So what did the Supreme Court say further?
Ma'am, I have a doubt.
Yes.
Ma'am, do you mean if this boyfriend is caught red-handed in the husband's property, and if he has a chance to escape the situation, but still he acts in private defense, so would that private defense be considered legitimate, legal?
No. Consider about that when the husband catches him. No, let's first read this para that is talking about it to the wall. Angered by the rebuff given by the deceased while declining to sell the melons, Gangaram went home, returned to the market with the young Ramswarup, who on the finding of the High Court, carried a gun with him. Evidently, they went to the market with a preconceived design to pick up quarrel. What semblance of a right did they have? They then have to be piqued at the resistance put up by the deceased and his men. They themselves were the lawless authors of the situation in which they found themselves, and though the common law doctrine of retreat to the wall or retreat to the ditch, as expounded by Blackstone, has undergone modification and is not to be applied in to cases where a victim, being in a place where he has a right to be, is in the face of grave uninvited danger, yet at least those in fault must attempt to retreat, unless the severity of the attack renders such a course impossible. The exemption from retreat is generally available to the faultless alone. This exemption from retreat is available to the faultless alone. So whether we can say the boyfriend got red-handed is faultless?
No.
Yeah, so that you will have to build your argument on those lines. Quite apart from the consideration as to who was initially at fault, the extent of the harm which may lawfully be inflicted in self-defense is limited. That we already know. Then, but how do you determine how much force is sufficient? It is necessary, incident of the right to private defense, that the force used must bear a reasonable proportion to the injury to be averted. That is, the injury inflicted on the assailant must not be greater than is necessary for the protection of the person assaulted. Is whether in this case, this is of consequence, whether the question hinges on the question of whether the force used by Ram Swarup is adequate or not?
If we consider that the private defense concept, then of course it was justified because the other party was also carrying weapons, and if they hit with lathis on the head, that would also cause certain death.
Mm-hmm.
So the force was like proportionate.
No, the question I'm basically asking is that if our understanding is that they were the aggressor in any case, so then is it of any relevance to find out what were the injuries given to Gangaram?
It is important to determine how much force should be used in retaliation.
Ma'am, it was found that in the case of Gangaram, there were 4 contusions on,
right,
and the injuries were simple in nature.
Mm-hmm. So this is even if we were to assume, so that alternate arguments happening here. One is that there was no right of private defense; they were the aggressor. The other one was that whether even if they had the right of private defense, have they exceeded the right of private defense, or they have exercised the right of private defense? So if 4 contusions मालूम है क्या होता है? घुमड़े, घुमड़े में ना तो चोट लगती है तो ऐसा फूल जाता है सर. So here 4 contusions, and they were simple in nature. So if these injuries were received before Ram Swarup fired, whether these were justified to use gun at point blank range? Manimji was shot on the chest, and the blackening and tattooing around the wound shows that Ram Swarup fired his shot from a very close range. So whether this will be a case of exceeding the right of private defense then? So they are kind of looking at the alternative scenario, that assuming that they had a right to private defense, then whether the force used was proportional, but that is also another aspect of the whole. So one, whether they had a right of private defense. If they had a right of private defense, then whether the action taken by them was proportionate, which is a requirement of the law. Section 100 categorically says, right of private defense extend to causing death if the offense which occasioned the exercise is falling into the categories listed there. We looked at the 7 categories yesterday. Whether 4 contusion fall in any of these categories?
No, ma'am.
So therefore, Ram Swarup had no right to cause death, and he has caused death. Presence of blood near the door leading to room number 2 and the parrot marks on the door frame show that Ram Swarup fired at the deceased when the latter was fleeing in fear of his life. In any event, therefore, there was no justification for killing the deceased selectively. Right of defense ends with the necessity for it. So if Murimji was already running away, the right has come to an end also. 102, right of private defense of the body commences as soon as reasonable apprehension of danger to the body arises, continues as long as such apprehension of danger continues. High Court refused to attach any significance to the pellet mark on the door frame, as it thought that the gunfire which hit the chowkhat was not the one which struck the deceased. But then this is contrary to the original position, which said that only one shot was fired. So therefore, the Supreme Court has pointed out the contradictions in the High Court position. So at one point, they're saying, you know, chowkhat was a different wound, and the wound on the deceased was from a different pallet. So then that means there were more. Basically, there was no reason to suppose that the shot which killed the deceased was not the one which hit the doorframe. It is quite clear that the deceased was shot after he left his gaddi and while he was about to enter room number 2 in order to save his life. So when you look at this, sir, more minutely, they say it is one can do that, but they also say that this is the section 105 is referring to the what I was saying, that when a person is accused of any offence, the burden of proving the existence of circumstances bringing that case within any of the general exceptions is upon him, and the court shall presume the absence of such circumstances. The High Court must, of course, have been cognizant of this provision, but the judgment does not reflect this. They've been very critical of the High Court decision in this one, and they've referred to the earlier judgment also, which explained the true nature and effect of the different types of presumptions under Section 105. Initial presumption regarding the absence of circumstances in the case with an exception may be met by showing the existence of appropriate facts. The burden to establish the plea of private defense is a more difficult burden to discharge. The judgment points out that despite this position, there may be cases where though the plea of private defense is not established by an accused on a balance of probabilities, yet the totality of facts and circumstances may still throw a reasonable doubt on the existence of mens rea. The respondent have led no evidence to prove their defense, but that is not necessary also, because such proof can be offered by relying on the evidence led by the prosecution. The conclusion of the High Court that Ramprasad was acting in private defense is unsupportable. Therefore, they said that there was no right to private defense to them. So in this case, if they did not have a right to private defense, then the whole point of proportionality does not arise. Then they looked into the fact that Gangaram was acquitted of the charge of 307. 307 is what? Attempt to murder in regard to the knife attack on Nalachand. Nalachand received no injuries. So there's no substance in the charge against Gangaram. He cannot be said to have delivered his license gun to Ram Sarup. The better view is that Ram Sarup took it, and therefore confirm the order of acquittal. So there are two appeals have been against both Gangaram as well as Ram Sarup. So they have confirmed that Ram Sarup's acquittal was fine, but Gangaram's acquittal was fine. But Ram Sarup, there's nothing. It was said that it was given to him. That has not been proved. Ram Sarup opened the gunfire, and Shivdatta Malla said that just after coming forward, Ram Sarup opened the gunfire. Evidence of the other three witnesses points in the same direction. True that these witnesses have said Gangaram and Ram Sarup challenged with one voice the authority of the deceased, but in discarding that part of the evidence, we do not think that the High Court has committed any palpable error requiring the interference of this court. Such title evidence of expostulations on the eve of an attack is often spicy and tends to strain. We therefore confirm the order of acquittal of Gangaram. You said something?
Ma'am, we have a class right now.
Okay.
Class.
So ma'am?
Yes. Ma'am, I have a doubt.
Yes. Can we ask this tomorrow? Can we ask this tomorrow?
I can ask tomorrow. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, because we're already late and you have a class, it's better to go. Please mark your attendance.
Thank you, ma'am.
And please read your subsequent cases for tomorrow. You have spent so much time just trying to understand what has happened and what the court have said. It should come as a lucid story. If you were to tell your neighbor what is the story about this case, that's how you narrate the facts initially. And then say, what is it that the judges have said? What are the legal points we are learning from this case? The legal points we have learned in this case, aggressor cannot be taking the position of the defense. When aggressors become are being attacked, then they cannot take the plea of private defense. There is no duty to retreat on the victim. Proportionality principle.
Right of defense should not exceed.
Sorry? Proportionality. Proportionality principle. So these are the few principles we have learned in this case. We'll look at the other three cases tomorrow.
Excuse me, ma'am?
Yes.
Ma'am, could you share your email ID?
Why do you need my email ID?
Ma'am, I wanted to ask you regarding some things of crimes only, if you're comfortable sharing the email ID.
I think you've already written to me, Ayush.
Yes, ma'am. I did not receive a reply. That's why I was asking.
Yeah, I saw you in the class.
Oh, okay, ma'am. I thought you did not see it. I'm so sorry, ma'am. Thank you so much.
No, I've seen that.